and communities to keep some of our history, because that's what makes it unique, because I have a heart for this. So, and I'm not alone. There are other people who feel like that too.
And can you just tell us a little bit about living in Bel Air? And
I love it. When we moved here, and our realtor took us to several places, but the minute I saw Bel Air, I knew this is where I wanted to live.
I think Bel Air is such a unique and special place to live. A lot of it is because it's small.
There's lots of towns on both coasts that have a beach close by and a country club with a pool, you know, a golf club per se, but haven't always had a lot of the hometown feel that we have here.
We didn't have a lot, but the hotel was really special.
I went to nursery school at a school at the bottom of the bluff, and I still run into a few people who I went to nursery school with there.
So now I feel like I'm Floridian instead of South Carolinian.
You know, you can't do it unless you have the people. People that really want to see the town flourish.
What's important when it comes to educating our future residents and the children of town to understand the deep, rich history of the town of Bel Air.
Now, along came the very wealthy Northerners from New York, looking for a place to build something where they and their families would have a place to come in the winter. These people selected this area that happened to be 47 to 48 feet above sea level on a high bluff looking out over Clearwater Bay, and Bellevue Biltmore Hotel.
The hotel itself was built in 1897, and several U.S. presidents stayed there while they were in office. And the golf course here where the Bel Air Country Club is the oldest golf course in Florida. It was also founded by Henry Plant, and in 1909 it was reworked by Donald Ross, a famous golf course designer.
So Bel Air, in probably the late 20s and 30s, first of all, there were 15,000 people here in Clearwater, and there was an enclave of well-to-do people who lived here, who played golf and who socialized.
And one time, it was interesting, I was on my bike riding up Indian Rocks Road, right, and Babe Ruth was playing golf. And he was right there on the hole, right close to the street. So I stopped my bike to watch. And I stayed still. And he looked up at me and he said, "Somebody stepped on my ball." His ball had gone into the damp ground. And he thought I had stepped on it. I had jumped out of my bike, off my bike. Anyway, that was interesting. I wish I could have a camera with me and take a picture of Ruth, of Babe Ruth.
There were a lot of military people stationed at MacDill Air Force Base and at the Bellevue Biltmore Hotel.
The hotel was used to house Army personnel. Everything was torn out of it. It was filled with bunk beds, barracks. They would march on the grounds. The people along what was the golf course or close to the hotel had to all use blackout curtains.
One name that we've heard quite a bit and we've been looking into the history is Roebling. What can you tell us about? We've heard a lot of stories, but
Donald Roebling was a giant of a man, physically giant. war, he built his amphibian tank.
And when the Marines took up on it, they thought that's exactly what we need for the war.
So it was a very interesting story because he developed that what's called the Alligator now, right on Woodlawn Avenue, which is at the end of the street. As he was developing this tractor, Alligator, he would take the Cub Scouts, the Boy Scouts, people on rides all over town.
So my husband had just finished his military at Quantico. They took up on that right away. That's what we need in the South Pacific. And so that's how we came down here, to study those and to teach. And that's how I met him. And he was there about 3 years. And when he got home, we got married.
Those people came back after the war and bought houses. And Florida boomed and Bel Air boomed. And so many of the people were young at the time, after World War II, and in the 50s and 60s, and Bel Air boomed again.
We also at one point had a casino off of Coe Road.
It was associated with the hotel, and at one time they did have an underground tunnel that went from the hotel to the casino. The casino was supposed to be strictly for hotel residents. Occasionally some local people would sneak in. It was raided by the police in about the 50s, I guess. There's pictures of them, you know, breaking up the gambling machines and everything like Elliot Ness would do. And it was closed down eventually.
My step-grandfather and some other people wanted to have an artist colony. So they started the Florida Gulf Coast Art Center so that people could come down and be, and they were patrons of the art. And Mrs. Shillard Smith had a gallery in her house.
And it was a school. One took courses there too with some outstanding instructors. And we had lots of festive activities. And whenever we needed money to pay the director or any other project, we had an event.
More recently, there were a lot of politics about the Art Center and what to do. But the upshot was a lot of politics and a lot of money, and it was sold and torn down, as was the mansion, which was on the water at the end of Bayview Drive. It's gone. It was the most stunning place you've ever seen.
And then the last topic that you had brought up that you wanted to talk about was U.S. Steel.
This was a almost decade-long history in our town. Prior to it starting, no one really had much to do with U.S. Steel, but they bought a good portion of the property along the Bellevue, the Biltmore Hotel. Those condos you see there, not the ones they're building now, but the 7 or 8 story, they all look similar, were all built by U.S. Steel. The town went crazy over them building the condos there. There were neighbors who no longer talked to each other over this.
U.S. Steel and the town, working through the Planning and Zoning Committee, came up with the Residential Plan Development, which it still stands. That document was written over blood, sweat, and tears, and it contained basically what could be built and what could not be built, with this major stipulation the green spaces, the golf courses, would remain green forever. And that's how the town got those golf courses. It was written into, it still is written into the residential plan development.